Hello and welcome to my class. In this video, I'm going to talk about post-embryonic development in insects. This video is the first part of the series on insect growth and development. Here I will talk about development and metamorphosis. In the second part, I will talk about the hormonal, genetic, and neural control of metamorphosis. And in the third part, I will talk about the types of larvae and pupae found in different insects. So let's begin with insect development. Insect development can be divided into two stages. The first stage is known as the embryonic development, which begins with the first mitotic division of the zygotic nucleus and terminates at hatching. Once the egg hatches, the post-embryonic development begins, and that terminates with the emergence of the adult or the imago. To understand this concept, let's take the help of this picture. This is a small wasp nest where the mother wasp has laid the eggs. Now, if I take out the contents of these cells here, then I can see the eggs. But if you look carefully, then this one looks a little different. That's because here the larva has hatched from the eggshell. So, in all this, the embryonic development is continuing, whereas in this one, the post-embryonic development has begun. Embryonic development within the egg usually starts after fertilization in sexually reproducing insects. So, in sexually reproducing insects, as the sperm nucleus fuses with the egg nucleus, that acts as a trigger to start the embryonic development. The zygote nucleus subdivides by mitotic division to produce many daughter nuclei, but they do not divide with their plasma membrane. Okay, so this gives rise to a syncytium. These nuclei and their surrounding cytoplasm, which is also known as the cleavage energetes, they migrate to the egg's periphery where the membrane formation starts. And that membrane formation leads to cellularization of a superficial layer to form the one cell thick blastoderm. This blastoderm usually gives rise to all the cells of the larval body, whereas the central yolky part of the egg provides the nutrition for the developing embryo. In developmental biology terms, this kind of cleavage is known as the superficial cleavage. So, as the egg hatches, the next stage starts, that is the post-embryonic development. If we look at a nest which has been there for about a month, then we will see the eggs have all hatched and we will see different stages of larva. And we will also see a pupa. Now, let's take out the contents of this nest and see what we find. We will still find some eggs which are going through the embryonic development, and then we will see larvae which are hatching from the egg. Then the larva, small, bigger larva. Then we see a separate stage which looks very different than the larva as well as the imago or the adults. This stage is known as the pupa. This is the transitional stage between these two stages. Okay. And then finally, we have the adult or the imago that comes out from the pupal chamber as an completely transformed adult. So here we have the embryonic development, and from here to here we have the post-embryonic development. Post-embryonic development is a discontinuous process because it is divided into a series of stages, and each stage is divided from the next by a molt. What is a molt? To understand the molt, we have to first look at the exoskeleton of an insect's larva. An insect's larva or an adult insect is covered by a cuticular exoskeleton, which renders protection to the insect. Now, the soft-bodied insect cannot grow beyond the cuticular layer. So, it needs to come out of that cuticular layer and form a bigger one. But if it first comes out of the exoskeleton and then forms another exoskeleton, it will be prone to the environmental dangers. So what it does is, it first makes the older exoskeleton loose from the body, Then it forms a new exoskeleton inside the older exoskeleton and then comes out from the older exoskeleton with the new exoskeleton. Now the process of separation of the epidermis from the existing cuticle is known as apolysis. Through this process, the older exoskeleton becomes loose from the body. The next stage is ecdysis, where the older exoskeleton is cast off or shed off and the insect comes out with the new exoskeleton. So these two steps make the molting process. So as I was saying that the post-embryonic development is a discontinuous process. The larva does not just grow in size. In between the growth stages, we find the molting stages. And each molt is characterized by the apolysis and the ecdysis. The form that the insect assumes between two molts is known as the instar. So this one is the first instar. This one is the second instar, this one is the third instar, this one is the fourth instar. When the insect is going through that molting process, that stage is known as the pheraid stage. Now, the period in which the insect is in between two molts, that period, that time is known as the stadium. So, the second instar larva will be in the second stadium. The third instar larva will be in the third stadium and so on. The number of molts can vary from insect to insect. But once it attains the adult stage or it attains sexual maturity, then it does not go through any more molting. So the last molting happens when the pupa becomes the adult. There are some exceptions, of course, but I will talk about that in a little while. To recap the whole story, the egg hatches into the larva. Before the hatching, this is the embryonic development. After the hatching, this process is the post-embryonic development. So we have the larva growing in size, but it cannot grow unless the exoskeleton, older exoskeleton, is shed off. That process is known as molting. Molting has two steps. One is apolysis, or making the outer exoskeleton loose, then formation of a new exoskeleton within, and then coming out of that older exoskeleton. First step is known as apolysis. Second step is known as the ecdysis. In between, the insect forms the new exoskeleton. When the insect is in the process of making the new exoskeleton, it is also known as the pheraid. And between two molts, the insect is known as the molt, as the instar or the stage. So this is the second instar, this is the third instar and so on. And the time period in which the insect is between two molts, that time is known as the stadium. Okay, plural is stadia. After the pupa molts, there is no further molting in insects. Now, we will go into a little more detail about how this molting takes place. If you are a BSc student, you do not have to study this part. But if you are an MSc student, then I strongly suggest that you go through this part as well. Alright, so let's look at the structure of the cuticle. The cuticle has a the exoskeleton. The exoskeleton has a cellular level known as the epidermis, which stands on the basement membrane. Then we have the cuticular layer. Cuticular layer can be divided into endocuticle, exocuticle and epicuticle. And in between endo and exocuticle, there can be another layer known as the mesocuticle. But in most books, you will find the endocuticle, exocuticle and epicuticle parts. Okay, now what happens is during the intermolt period, that is when the insect is not going through the moltings between two molts, then the cuticular layer is attached to the epidermal cell layer by plaques that anchor the base of the cuticle to the microvilli. Now, what happens during the molting? As I said before, the molting starts with the apolysis. So the epidermal cells undergo mitotic growth and increase their density and shape. So they change in shape as well as in size and in numbers. So that causes apolysis, or this layer becomes loose from this layer. The separation of the cuticle from the epidermis creates an area between the cuticle and the epidermis. This area is known as the exuvial space. Very soon, a formation of the exuvial space, it becomes filled with a gel called the molting gel. What is this molting gel? It is basically a cocktail of some inactive enzymes like chitinase and protease. So it has the older exoskeleton, it has the epidermis and an exuvial space in between, which is now filled with molting gel. And molting gel is a mixture of the inactive enzymes. After that, the epidermis starts to secrete a new envelope or a new exoskeleton. Now, once that happens, then this molting gel becomes the molting fluid. Because this molting gel had the inactive enzymes, it could not digest anything. But the molting fluid, which is the changed version of the same molting gel, now has the active enzymes. These active enzymes can only digest the endocuticle. But once the epidermis has secreted a new exoskeleton that has the epicuticle outside, and that in those enzymes cannot act on the epicuticle, but it can work on the endocuticle. So only the exoskeleton, the older exoskeleton's endocuticle is facing the molting fluid. So this part gets digested, whereas the new exoskeleton protects the epidermal layer. The molting fluid begins the digestion of the old unsclerotized endocuticle, but not the sclerotized exocuticle above. So this part gets digested, but not this part. Okay. As the old cuticle is digested and the envelope presents a continuous layer, the epidermal cells begin to secrete the new procuticle using the recycled raw materials during the declining phase of 20-ectoisin production. The synthesis of the new epicuticle continues with the formation of the inner epicuticle. Okay, so basically this part gets digested and this part has a new layer which protects the epidermal layer. Just before ecdysis, the pore canals release the components of the wax layer on the surface of the outer epicuticle and assures the waterproofing of the new cuticle before the old cuticle is discarded. So this layer now, here we are assuming that a new layer has formed. This new layer gets coated with a waxy secretion and that protects the insect when it comes out of the older exoskeleton. Okay, so this is a waterproof layer. Now with 20-ectoisin now at its low intermolt level, a complex sequence of stereotyped behaviors follow. What are those? Like the insect would start drinking some water or it will swallow some air. As a result, the insect's body will expand. As it expands, the ecdysial layers of the older exoskeleton will break the older exoskeleton. So, ecdysial lines are basically some points which are thinner in epicuticle. So, at those points, the older exoskeleton will break and the insect will come out from the inside of the older exoskeleton with the new exoskeleton. Hope this part makes sense. So at the summary of this part is basically the older exoskeleton becomes detached from the epidermal layer and the endocuticle of the older exoskeleton gets digested by the enzymes present in the molting fluid, and a new exoskeleton is formed here, which protects the epidermal layer as well as it protects from the enzymes as well as from the outer environment when it comes out of the older exoskeleton. So once the older exoskeleton is loose, then the insect within can come out with the new exoskeleton. So coming out is known as ecdysis and loosening of it is known as apolysis. Apolysis happens first, then ecdysis happens. Now, another term that you are going to come across very often in entomology is the sclerotization. So, cuticular sclerotization, which is also known as tanning, is a process that stabilizes the protein matrix of the cuticle to make it stiffer and harder, more insoluble, and more resistant to degradation. This process gives the integument greater strength for muscle attachment and locomotion, and provide stability against hydrolytic enzymes produced by potential pathogens such as fungi. So it not only helps in giving strength to the muscles for locomotion, but also protects from the outer environment. Now that brings us to a point where the insect goes through metamorphosis. So we have covered the part where the insect larva grows in size, or the growth happens. Now, as I showed you the pictures of the wasp nest before, you might remember that there was a transitional phase called the pupa, which helped in transitioning from the larva into the adult. Okay, so that stage actually brings us to the phenomenon of metamorphosis. During larval development, there is usually no marked change in body form. So one larva is very similar to the one it is going to become. So the first insta larva is only different from the second insta larva in shape and size. It is not different in any other body parts. But the degree of change from last stage larva to the adult varies considerably and may be very marked. Okay, so from pupa to adult, or from the last nymph, we will come to the nymph part in a while, but last nymph to adult, that change is very significant change, and that change also shows many marked differences between the two stages. So those stages, or that change, is called the metamorphosis. And it can be related to the loss of adaptive features peculiar to the larva and the gain of features specific to the adult. So there is change that entails a larva to become the adult, and in that process there are some characters which are specific to the larva, they are lost, and some characters which are specific to the adult are gained. Metamorphosis happens with the help of the hormone called juvenile hormone. It has to be absent for one molt for the growth. Juvenile hormone is very important, okay, or for keeping the larval characters, for retaining the characters of the larva or the nymph, the juvenile hormone is very important. But to go through the last stage, the juvenile hormone has to be very low and the ecdysin hormone has to be high. So we will come to that in the second part, how these hormones change the metamorphosis process or help in growth and metamorphosis. But for the time being, just know that juvenile hormone has to go low. I mean, the concentration of juvenile hormone has to go down for the metamorphosis to take place. Now, there are three types of metamorphosis in insects. The first one is known as no metamorphosis. Then the second one is known as gradual metamorphosis or incomplete metamorphosis. And the third part is known as the complete metamorphosis. And you can see them in these three types of insects. See, when a silverfish grows It just grows in size. And as it grows, it just attains the sexual maturity in one of the stages, and then it continues to grow in size by molting. So here, there is no metamorphosis. These kind of insects are known as ametabolous insects. The second type is where the young individual is very similar to the adult individual, but there are some characters gained in them. These insects are known as hemimetabolous insects, and they go through the incomplete metamorphosis or gradual metamorphosis. And here you can see that the larva and the adult are very different, and they need a pupal stage to transition from the larval stage to the adult stage. These kind of insects are known as holometabolous insects, and they show complete metamorphosis. So we have three types of insects that we have come across. One is ametabolous insects, then hemimetabolous insects, and holometabolous insects. In ametabolous insects, metamorphosis is absent. The adult form results from a progressive increase in size of the larval form. At each molt, the larva grows bigger and the genitalia develop progressively. Adults and larvae live in the same habitat. So there is no change in habitat or feeding habit or anything. In between the larva and adult, there is just development of genitalia. There is no wing in these insects, so there is no question of wing growth. Hemimetabolous insects are different than them. In here, young form resembles the adult except for its small size and lack of wings and genitalia. However, it may have some other characteristic features that are absent in the adult. At the final molt, these features are lost. So these are the hemimetabolous insects. You can see in this grasshopper, this is a picture of a nymph where you can see the small wings growing. And in the final instar, these wings will grow completely. And then we come to the most advanced insects, who are known as the holometabolous insects. Here, there is a stark metamorphosis. And usually soft bodied larval stages become the adult through a transitional phase known as the pupa. Okay. Now we are going to talk about the wing part of hemimetabolous and holometabolous insects, because the wing formation is very different in hemimetabolous and holometabolous insects. The young hemimetabolous insects are known as the nymphs, and the young holometabolous insects are commonly known as the larva. In some books, you will find the common word larva for both hemimetabolous and holometabolous ones. But it is more customary to call the young hemimetabolous insects as the nymphs. Okay, now in nymphs, as you have seen in the picture of the grasshopper, the wing buds develop slowly and gradually. So in the smaller nymphs, you would not see any wing buds, but as they grow bigger, they will start growing their wings. And in hemimetabolous insects, the wings develop as external buds, which become larger at each molt. Finally, when the adult emerges, they have the biggest size of wings. In holometabolous insects, however, the wings develop in invaginations of the epidermis beneath the larval cuticle. Remember the picture of the exoskeleton? So inside the epidermis, there is an ingrowth which forms the wing buds of the holometabolous insects. Afterwards, those invaginations become everted and they become the wing in the pupal phase. Okay, so as you see that in hemimetabolous insects and in holometabolous insects, the development of wing is very different. And this brings us to the two divisions. All hemimetabolous insects are grouped under division Exopterygota because their wings develop externally. And all holometabolous insects, the wings first develop internally, then they develop externally. So they are grouped under division Endopterygota. we will go into a little more detail about the hemimetabolous metamorphosis first. As you see that the insects grow in size, and when they do, this is the first instar of nymph and this is the adult. As they grow in size, the wing buds start to develop and their wings gradually develop to become the big wings in the adult. Now there is another difference here. There are two types of metamorphosis within the hemimetabolous metamorphosis. The first type, where only the wing development and genitalia development can be seen, those types of metamorphosis in hemimetabolous insects is known as gradual metamorphosis. But in some nymphs, like in order Ephemeroptera, Odonata, etc., we see that the larva or the young one is an aquatic one. Okay, so this one remains in water, so it needs a respiratory organ which can respire in water. So for that, they have the gills. This is the naiad. It is not called a nymph anymore. This is a nymph, but this is called a naiad. N-A-I-A-D, naiad. And this naiad has the external gills. Now, this is damselfly's naiad, and here the gills are external. And in dragonflies, the gills are internal, inside the rectum. Basically, these gills help to respire in water. Now, the naiad is aquatic, but the adult is not, right? So, in adult, the respiratory system is completely tracheal respiration. So, the young and the adult are very different. However, they are put under hemimetabolous metamorphosis because there is no pupal stage as such. Okay, so the adult molts from the or comes out from the naiad stage, and this one develops the wings later. Okay, and it loses the respiratory gills. Unlike in gradual metamorphosis, where they feed the same food, that is, in hemipteran insects, they both, the nymph as well as the adults, both have piercing and sucking mouthparts, and they both feed on plant sap. And the only difference is the development of the wing in the adult and development of the genitalia in the adult. But here, there is also the loss of respiratory gills involved in this metamorphosis. So, this one is known as the gradual metamorphosis, and this one is known as incomplete metamorphosis. This kind of metamorphosis is found in most exopterygotes, and this one is found in Plecoptera, Ephemeroptera and Odonata. Here, they have aquatic larvae, so they have very different kind of food habit as well as respiratory habit. As the adult comes out from the last molt, they have aerial habits, they have different food habits, and they have trachea for respiration. So, larval gills are lost here, wings are developed in the adults, genitalia are developed in the adults. Although they are different from the gradual metamorphosis, the general body form resembles that of an adult, and these insects are also included under hemimetabolous metamorphosis. Now we come to the last part, which is the holometabolous metamorphosis. In holometabolous metamorphosis, we see that the egg hatches into the larva. The larva grows bigger in size through the molting processes. And then the adult is very different from the larva. And to become the adult, the larva has to go through the pupal stage, which is a transitional phase between the larva and the pupa. Here you can come back to the wasp's picture. If we take out the contents of a very mature nest, this is what we will find. Here are the eggs where the embryonic development is going on. And then here we see different sizes of larvae which are going through the post-embryonic development. Here this is a pupa which has just transitioned from the larval phase. And here you can see the pupa at different stages of growth. The wing buds are growing here, and in the last pupal stage, you can see the well-developed wings. Finally, from this stage, it is ready to come out as an imago or the adult. A very common example of holometabolous insects are butterflies. I think you have studied about butterfly metamorphosis since a very young age. To recap the whole story, insect development can be divided into two stages. The first stage is known as the embryonic development, which begins with the zygote and ends with hatching. So the first mitotic division of the zygotic nucleus begins the embryonic development and it terminates at hatching. At hatching, the post-embryonic development begins and it terminates at emergence of adults. Post-embryonic development can be divided into many types. There are four different types here. First one, where there is no metamorphosis, these insects are known as ametabolous insects. They grow in a gradual process through molting, but they do not stop molting after attaining sexual maturity. Next type is a gradual metamorphosis. They also grow gradually, but once they reach sexual maturity, they do not go through any more molting. The wing buds develop very apparently in a gradual process in these insects. Next type is incomplete metamorphosis. These two metamorphoses are included under hemimetabolous insects. But in incomplete metamorphosis, we see some more differences in the young form than the adult form. Because the young forms are aquatic, so they have respiratory system which are adapted for the aquatic life. They have respiratory gills. But the adult is aerial, so it has the tracheal system. The feeding habit is also very different in this insect as well as in this one. Now, in complete metamorphosis, we see the egg, larva, pupa and adult stages, and these insects are known as holometabolous insects. Here I will end this part. Hope you liked this part. Please come back for the next part where I will talk about the genetic, neural and hormonal control of metamorphosis. Thank you.